are interested. But here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to hopefully have a little bit of time, just a little bit of time to talk at you. But what I want to do is let you ask some questions and maybe have dialogue too. I think just to get things started, I'll tell you a little bit about Frontier. Who's heard of Frontier before? I guess you guys saw a video yesterday. Before yesterday, who's heard of Frontier? All right, a few people. Herbs and spices, body care products. I'll tell you a little bit more about that. I'll tell you what I do as a sustainable supply chain manager, the sustainable supply chain manager, because there's not anyone else doing exactly the same thing in the company as me. I'll give you a little bit of sense of how I got to this point in my career, a little bit of a roundabout path, but I'll tell you about that. And then what I want to do, since at least some of you are Spanish students, is talk about the importance of language and kind of more broadly cultural appreciation and understanding as you do business, but also as you travel and just kind of are engaging in the world. Start by just a little bit of background on the company. It's an Iowa-based company. Founded 40 years ago, this is our 40th anniversary in this little wood cabin on the Cedar River. It's now grown into a much bigger company. The headquarters is in Norway, Iowa. I tell people the headquarters is in Norway, and they say, well, you work for an international company. I do work for an international company, but Norway, Iowa. I work in North Liberty, off of 380. We have a facility in Urbana and a facility in Beltane, too. There are about 500 employees at the company now. We manufacture about 2,000 different products that get distributed across the United States and also in Canada. I think we're the market leader in organic and natural herbs and spices, and one of the market leaders in essential oils. Three brands that you may have seen around the house or in the grocery store. The spice brands, also teas and herbs, are this Frontier brand and Simply Organic. The essential oils brand and body products is Oracacia. Excuse me. This is what some of the products look. These are bottles of spices that you see in the grocery store. You see them. I think we've got a little presence in Hy-Vee. Certainly, if you go to New Pie Co-op, which is open in Cedar Rapids, you'll see the products there. They're big, not in this part of the country, but Whole Foods, which is a huge natural grocery chain, publicly traded chain, we have a big presence there. What's interesting about the products, number one, the spices, literally hundreds of different spices, hundreds of commodities that come from over 50 countries around the world. The way that we market the products and what you see on the label, I think, is very reflective of the ethics of the company. A lot of our products are organic certified and fair trade certified. I've been asking in every class, who knows what organic products are?
Anybody?
I'm raising my hand, kind of.
Just like all natural stuff without preservatives?
Yeah, that's part of it. Anyone else? Yeah.
Without, they're not GMOs or genetically modified. They're specifically, like, they aren't specifically modified for
products. That is a specific part of it. Yep, that's right. So basically, they are natural, but more than just that, no synthetic chemicals are allowed in the production. And you're right, non-GMO is part of it. So no genetically modified crops are allowed to be certified as organic. So from the farm gate, from what the farmer's putting on the crops, all the way to how it's processed and how it's packaged, no synthetic chemicals are involved. So the farmers that we work with for our organic products, not all of them are organic, but the organic certified products, they're not using pesticides, they're synthetic, they use natural stuff. Same goes with fertilizers. When we sterilize the commodities here in our plant, we can't use irradiation, which is not allowed under organic certification. We use steam sterilization, which is a natural process, so that's right. So a lot of the products are organic certified, fair trade certified. Anyone know that one? A little bit less common.
Fair trade?
Fair trade means that the farmers who produce the agricultural commodities have gotten a fair deal. So a lot of these agricultural commodities, coffee, tea, spices, cotton, a lot of them are produced in other parts of the world. A lot of them are produced in countries that were colonized by Europe or the United States, where, historically speaking, farmers were not given a very good price, in many cases exploited. The commodities were taken out of those countries, sold for a big profit in the Western world, and that didn't get back to the farmers. So the idea with fair trade is to make sure that the farmers are actually getting a fair shake. It means income. It means oftentimes that we work with farmer cooperatives that are providing other kinds of services to the farmers to make sure that the supply chain works for everybody. So you'll see that on the products. You'll see on a lot of these, they were grown by a farmer co-op, non-GMO, like you were saying, no irradiation. That's what a lot of our products are about. So what do I do at the company? I am the Sustainable Supply Chain Manager, a title that my boss let me make up for myself. But here's what I do. Frontier, as I mentioned, is a company that does care about the social and environmental impacts of the business. We are a company, though, and that means we need to make money. To stay in business, we need to make profit. So my focus is on really looking for opportunities where the business needs and the business interests of the company overlap with social and environmental impact opportunities to make a positive and social, a positive social and environmental impact. It's what I call the sweet spot area, where those two things are overlapping. So if we use less electricity in our plant, it's good for the environment, less electricity, right? But it saves us money, too. And so that's a win-win for the environment and the company. There are some times where you do have to make difficult decisions. So, for example, if we are paying farmers more, that erodes our margin a little bit, you know? In the short term, one might argue that, you know, that's not a good business decision. You need to get the product at the cheapest possible price. Now, if you have a little bit of a longer term outlook, you say, wait a minute, if I can help that farmer earn enough to stay in business and his son or his daughter wants to take over the farming when he's done, well, then in terms of the long term viability of our supply chain, that's a smart business investment. But in the short term, you have to make those difficult decisions. So my job in the company is to look for those opportunities where there's an overlap and we can make a positive change in the world and also make decisions that are good for the business. So I'll tell you about a couple projects, three projects actually, that I'm involved with now that'll give you a little bit of a better sense of what some of my day-to-day is in this role. So this is a project that I've been working on for the last year. I heard a story on NPR a year ago about a group of military veterans, young people still in their 20s, served in Afghanistan. Came back to the States. A couple of them were at Harvard Business School. They decided to start a business exporting saffron from Afghanistan, where they had served. And they saw that in a country where the average income is, I think, $750 US a year, that there would be a real opportunity for farmers if they figured out how they could help them find international markets for their saffron. It would be a great way to actually improve their livelihoods. So they started doing that. I heard the story on NPR. You know, a lot of times in life you hear about someone doing something that strikes you as a good thing, but it's like, well, that's great, God bless them, but what can I do? I heard this thing, and I'm thinking, all right, where's Spike company? I gotta pick up the phone. We could actually potentially do some work with these folks. So it's been a year. There have been a lot of hurdles to get over, but we're actually in the process of switching over our saffron purchasing from these guys who have now finished Harvard Business School, set up shop in Chicago, and are exporting the saffron and selling it in the United States. Because of what we're doing, we're doubling the amount of saffron that these guys can bring out of Afghanistan this year. We put 75 women to work in their manufacturing facility. It's a win-win. And the saffron, it's great saffron. We couldn't have done it if it wasn't good saffron. It's pretty price competitive. And that's another good example of a win-win opportunity. Something else I'm involved with, we work with a number of the suppliers that we work with are actually farmer cooperatives. Not that different from a farmer cooperative that you might see here in Iowa, except we're dealing with farmers who farm on an acre or two of land and, you know, are in much more of a precarious situation economically. A lot of these organizations, for example, one that I work with in India, it was founded by the Catholic Church. They founded it to give farmers an opportunity to earn income. They wanted to encourage the farmers to grow organically and take care of the environment. They do all that stuff really well, totally mission-driven organization with the values of the Catholic Church. The question is, can they do business? Can they produce consistent quality that we can use? Can they deliver on time? Can they remain price competitive? Because if they can't do that stuff, it becomes very difficult for a company like Frontier to buy from them, and then they're not able to fulfill their social and environmental mission because they can't. I mean, if it's not a viable business, it's not a viable business. So these guys are good on the social and environmental. They are having some challenges as they grow as a business. So I've been working with them to put different systems in place to operate more effectively and efficiently as a business. So I went down there in September of last year, did a business assessment, identified opportunities for improvement. I'm going to go back in May, spend a couple weeks with them, put some systems in place, work with them over the next 6 to 12 months to make sure that the business is really running in a way that we as a buyer can feel confident that these guys are going to be there to buy from over 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, 10 years. We're, although for this part of Iowa, we're a reasonably sizable company, you know, on the global scene, we're a very small company. And so what that means is, well, we can do some good sourcing from a co-op here or working with a environmentally responsible organic supplier there. In terms of some of the issues in the supply chain that not only affect quality, food safety, but also the social and environmental stuff, there are some problems that are just, as a company, too big for us to deal with. So, for example, the vanilla supply chain. Most of the world's vanilla comes from Madagascar. It's an island off of Africa, if you don't know. There are some challenges on the ground in Madagascar that are affecting us as a business, but also affecting the farmers, that are, you know, too big for any one company to deal with. So, for example, farmers are picking their vanilla when it's unripe, which is not good for quality. And the reason they're doing that is because the security situation in Madagascar is such that they're worried that if they let their vanilla fully ripen, someone is going to come steal it from them, and then they're going to get nothing from it. Now, that's a situation that has to be dealt with at the government level. And so we've joined an organization called the Sustainable Vanilla Initiative that brings together the biggest vanilla importers in the world. Most of them are European-based, some are American-based. It's bringing together an exporters organization from Madagascar, and it's even bringing the Ministry of Commerce to the table. We're actually going to meet in Paris in a couple weeks, and we're going to talk about how do we, as a group, start to address some of these issues that ultimately, if we can find solutions, are going to be good for business, good for farmers, good for the government, good for all parties involved. So that's a pretty interesting initiative. That gives you a sense of some of the stuff that I'm involved with on a day-to-day. Pretty diverse range of projects, different countries, different challenges, different opportunities. What I'm going to do now is show you in the background, with the recognition that you may not pay attention to anything I'm saying, but I'm going to show you some pictures. These are all pictures that I've taken on work trips over the last 10 or 15 years. And while I show you those in the background, let me tell you a little bit about how I wound up doing what I do. And you know, maybe I'll give you guys some ideas of different ways that you can pursue some of this kind of work if you're interested. I grew up in the suburbs of New York City in a not very diverse community with no exposure to anything international whatsoever. In high school, my junior year, I found out about an opportunity between junior and senior year of high school to go live with a host family in another part of the world through a nonprofit organization called AFS, a non-religious organization, the mission of which is just to let kids from the States go visit families overseas and vice versa. If you get an exchange student in school, it'll be through this type of organization, this type of program. So I said, yeah, this sounds pretty cool, and I want to freak my parents out, so I'm going to figure out what's the farthest, weirdest place that I can go to. So I chose to go live with a family in Bangkok, in Thailand. I was there for just 3 months during the summer. I went to a high school. Their seasons are different, so high school was on during our summer. Went to a high school, life-changing experience, because all of a sudden it's like, whoa, it's not just about my, you know, pretty small, suburban, not terribly diverse town. Absolutely nothing wrong with that. Great place to grow up, but there's this whole world out there, and it's so different. And what better place than a place like Bangkok to really open your eyes to the fact that things are not just a little bit different, but really different. So I did that, came back to the States after a fantastic, challenging, but fantastic experience. Chose a college that would allow me to take classes and study in other parts of the world. There were no classes on Thailand, so I picked the next closest thing. I focused on studying India and South Asia, that part of the world. Again, senior year comes along, I decided I would do a semester away, which is something that folks are taking the college path and you have the opportunity to do a semester away. I would absolutely encourage you to do that wherever you go. I went to India, spent a semester there. Again, totally eye-opening experience. I was there a little bit longer. I was a little bit older, so I think my appreciation for things was probably a little bit more in-depth than it had been in high school. Also, as a second experience, I just fell in love with the country and the food and culture, and I was kind of